It's rolling.
We
okay, you're, oh, it's a video. It's a video.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, I thought you were making a picture. Yeah. Okay.
We stormed our brains a whole week to figure out some smart questions, but we came out with nothing.
I much prefer stupid questions.
Okay. We are full of stupid questions.
Okay, this is going to be
by,
fun.
By the way, for, our website is too much. Our web page is called Three Drunk Guys.
Okay, okay.
We have two of them. The and first, the other one is one home.
Well, three is a good number.
Yeah.
Actually, we have more like five. We started as three and we kept them in.
I understand. I mean, how many band members are in Syncrogees 3?
Yeah, something. Okay.
Where to start?
Let's just start with a random question.
Sure.
When will be the next Syncrogees album, the Book of Souls? I read on your website that it should have come out in the fall of 2010.
Actually, yeah, it probably should have come out in 2006.
Oh, okay.
And then I think that was the last time. We might have mentioned it one other time, and then fans have been mentioning it ever since. So we've stopped saying anything about it. I know that we're we recorded it yet another record in this October.
This October. Okay.
Mm-hmm. So.
The one with Mike Patton, the EP?
A new, a whole new record.
Oh, a whole new record, okay.
And so, that, we're not finished with that, but that the plan is to release that with Book of Souls.
Okay, cool. So but two records?
It's been close for a long time, it's just we keep going on fucking tour, and we can't finish it. I mean, it comes down to how much time is there in a year. And like, for example, this tour, I spent 2 months preparing for the tour, preparing new music. That's time that I can't spend recording.
Okay. So this is like exclusive news for our website, that you have a new record?
Yeah, as of now, I guess that's true. Nobody specifically asked me about that, so that's true, yeah.
Well, I read about the Book of Souls a couple of days ago, so. For me, it's new information. I completely forgot about
it. Book of Souls has turned into sort of like Chinese democracy, you know?
Okay, we understand. Another random question. Not the commercial. When they started talking to me about your concert here, they said the Syncrogees 3, the band of the legendary guitar player from Fame of War, Mr. Bungert, stuff like that. And I browsed the web and found out that you played with Fame of War last year in Chile, one full concert, King for a Day. And my question is, as a fan of both Fame of War and Secret Chief, actually, and Mr. Bungert, have you ever felt when you played with Fame of War on in 95 when the album came out, that you were a full member of the band, or just a guest musician?
Yeah, guest musician. I mean, I wrote guitar parts that I thought would fit their musical ideas.
Okay.
So I guess it's a little bit more than just being a guest and showing up and improvising or something. So I had creative input, but yeah, I never really had the status of a full band member. I don't think you have that until you go on tour with a band.
The question that every Mr. Bunger, Fame of War fan, would ask you that next, was that because of the fact that Mike Patton was in the band?
It was a factor because, put it this way, if the situation of me being in Fame No More was, I would put it this way, not a very good one. That has other things to do. If it's a guitar player who doesn't have anything else to do, it would have been a fine gig at the terms that they were offering to me. But we hadn't really figured out what those terms were until, well, all in good faith, I had finished recording the whole album. Like, we hadn't even talked about it. And then it became very clear the situation that they were in what they had to offer, not just money, just the whole thing, it was just not happening, like, at all. So, for me, it's like, okay, it's time for me to go, but you guys have plenty of time to find a new guy, and it's been a pleasure, you know, writing the parts and everything.
And they were cool.
Not really. At the time, I think they took it like, you know, what the fuck is this guy thinking? Mike certainly knew. He told me before I even joined, this isn't a good situation. You really shouldn't do it. So, like, I understood what he meant. I think I got out at the right time because I didn't want anything to mess up between he and I.
That's what I read some years ago, that Mike Patton didn't want you in the band.
Yeah, that was very wise of him.
And Billy Gould was the one that could.
I get along with all of those guys. Okay. And of course, I was a Faith No More fan. Like, Mike never really was. Like, in the 80s, I really loved their sort of early, the Cure kind of sound they had. Kind of creepy industrial thing. And I didn't like them as much once they had Mike Patton in the band.
Okay,
I'm not
kidding.
I mean,
of course, when Mike came in the Faith No More, the old sound, the old
it changed. Sound. Not that I didn't, that I hated it or anything. It was cool, but
for me, like, it changed in a better way.
Most people feel that way. Yeah. I'm in that small minority.
Okay. You are in the same. You are born in the same city as Mike Patton, Eureka, U.S.
I grew up in that. I wasn't born there, but I grew up there.
Is it true that Eureka is the city with the highest percentage of serial killers in the USA?
No. Where I live now is, it doesn't have serial killers. It has domestic violence and murder.
I have no idea where I read that.
It's,
probably
it's close
was alive.
It usually has about the same crime rate as Richmond or like bad parts of Oakland.
Oh, okay.
California.
Yeah.
So in the state of California, it's one of the most violent places.
Oh, okay.
And it's interesting because it's all white people pretty much. And usually, you know, when you hear these crime statistics, the thing that they're always saying, you know, it's the black people, the black part of town. No, Eureka is a proof that white people in similar conditions as to black people in ghettos act just as bad, if not worse.
We have a full country form of white people, and we are pretty violent.
Yeah, I mean, it's just if people are in bad conditions, they don't react very well.
And speaking about our country, he wanted to ask you about what influence.
What is your connection with Romania? I remember I read on a booklet of California that your music was influenced by Romanian gypsy music.
Oh yeah, well, I mean, it's my story with that is a little bit different than maybe the Mr. Bungle story, I guess.
Okay. You also played Chocolia.
Yeah.
Live sets, and you also put an album out with the Path of Most Resistance with Chocolia.
Yes, of course. Yeah, absolutely. And that, so now I know what Chocolia is. And
it's a bird.
And I have a bunch of recordings of it from the song. Different recordings from all different times. And you hear the bird chirping. It's funny because in Western Europe and the United States, the first thing anybody hears when they hear Romanian music is gypsy music, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's kind of funny when then you hear Ciocărlia, a song from a songbird in a village in Romania, this song then being used in Serbia for a military.
I read about that in Serbia, in Georgia, and in Israel even.
Yeah, for super, like, really right-wing sort of skinhead stuff. You're like, okay, so maybe some people want to have a debate about like ethnomusicology or something, but I think it's pretty clear. It's a fucking bird from a village in Romania. It's really not to do with any of that. And so if it's gypsy music, it just means that the gypsies took that song there, decontextualized it, somebody else started.
Actually, I remember I read somewhere that it's not the folkloric song.
Yeah.
It's actually a composed one.
Yeah, I bet.
By a guy that, from the name, I think he was a gypsy.
Really?
Yeah.
This is yet another chapter.
Yeah. I don't remember his name now. He was from a famous family of musicians. Most of the, because of the history of Romania, most of the musicians in 19th century, 18th century were gypsies.
Yeah, sure.
The Romanians were all of them peasants. Mm-hmm. They were working all day, and the gypsies had all the other
very musically literate people. Yeah, it's like ridiculous.
Not necessarily literate.
Musically literate.
Music. Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Oh,
they
yeah,
were
sure.
The ones that were playing music. In Romania, they are called lăuta. From lăuta, the instrument,
yeah,
the lute.
Yeah, lute, which is also lute.
So lăuta means the player with the lute.
Aha, okay.
But when he composed the song, he composed it for the flute.
Yeah.
I didn't know the English name.
Yeah, it's cool.
It's not my interview now.
What?
So you didn't know much about Romania before you came here.
It's a long fucking conversation. Also, the Bartok song, when he traveled around in Moldova and wrote down all of the melodies that would be lost if he hadn't written them down.
Yeah.
Also, very fucking interesting.
I wanted to come here tonight and give you a present. One of the CDs with Romanian, old Romanian music, but I forgot the CD at home. I'm so ashamed.
It's okay. It's my loss.
Another question from your Mr. Backup Past. Actually, it was a question from my patron, but I never had a chance to talk with him. I remember when on your first album, all of you had some nicknames, not your real names. Is it true that Mike Patton was Vlad Drac, his nickname?
I mean, if I remember right, yeah, I think so.
Because Vlad Drac was a Romanian ruler from the 15th century.
I know all about Vlad Tepes. I mean, yeah, of course. No, there's no correlation there.
No.
It's just a stupid bullshit.
Because in my mind, it all connects, you know? Chocolia, Vlad Drac, Romanian music.
Yeah, yeah, it's not, unfortunately, it's not really, but I've, since, I mean, I can tell you more, you know, like, my, I had a girlfriend for 2.5-3 years in the United States who's from Romania, but she's here now, she returned to Romania, and is in monastery, she's in monastic, so I know this side of Romania pretty well too now, like, and I've been actually, Cluj was the last part of Romania I've never seen. I've seen everywhere in Romania now.
What do you think?
I love it. I mean, it's an intense place. It's the first few times that I came. Like anywhere, if you're away from your home for a while, you feel like you don't belong somewhere and you should leave or something. And now every time I come here, I feel like there's some part of me that feels very at home here, which I don't feel in Western Europe. So it's nice. I love to come here a lot.
This would have been my next question. I remember in an old interview of you, that you said that you write Oriental-inspired music, but you don't expect people from Middle East to like your music, to understand your music.
We're not really taking influence from like Arab or Persian music directly, but having studied music theory systems from philosophical stuff that I'm very interested in, I've been coming up with music that's based on those principles. So instead of pretending like we know how to play any kind of Oriental music, to me it's, well, a saz is an instrument that can accommodate these different tuning systems. We can understand and internalize a different sense of rhythm than what comes naturally through Western music or Western notated music.
But do you feel that the audiences from Eastern Europe are more open to this kind of music?
It's very interesting because, yeah, when we play, and like even also in Turkey, everybody knows that it's not Turkish, or they know that it, you know, but it still feels fine.
Okay.
And it's not really such a novelty as, for example, if you play like in Northern Europe or something, in that audience, it's sort of, well, this is something interesting and new that they haven't heard. It's not so new, but there's still something mysterious and different about it.
It's a lot of something, not just a...
Frankly, most of what we play is straight up Western music when you come down to it. So it's a, you know, to me it's a, it's the... It isn't even that it's the combination, it's that no matter what perspective you look at it from, there's always something, something mysterious. Something that doesn't, isn't quite at home. But you can't ever figure out what that is necessarily. I love that. I love that ambiguity.
Okay, ask another question.
Anything.
It's sort of about, you know, about feeling like a stranger in the world.
Yeah.
You know, like if everywhere you go, you're a foreigner, even in the place that you were born. Sometimes
something we feel here in Romania.
So maybe we share this. We're at home with this idea of form. Something like that. To me, it's not about artificially combining stuff to make some weird hybrid. It's more like I feel the sort of. An unease, maybe it's an unease with my own history, how I arrived, how did I get born in California, like how did that process come to be where I would end up being born in this place, at the very edge of Western civilization where all these expectations, these utopian dreams basically came crashing up against a wall and everybody looks around and goes, well now what? You know. That to me,
I know exactly this feeling because you know if you were born here in Eastern Europe, you would wish all your life to be born in California.
So. Right. Yeah. And then that's sort of my thing is from California. I say okay, it's easy. It's an easy life, but it's also missing something. Something big. It's missing something very big.
Okay.
So that you know, that's why there's never it's never settled anywhere that you go. Because it isn't really about where you live. I think it's really about where you come from. You know, that's a very deep thing. It's not necessarily a geographical thing. You know, where you come from, where you're from.
And hey, your music is like a way to find out who you really are, who you really come,
yeah.
Where you come from.
I think if music isn't that, then it's not really worth very much. That's my opinion, but...
Okay.
Hey, Matt, could you... Shut that door. It's just loud, you know? Or is it shut?
That's shut.
Oh, okay, sorry.
I wanted to ask you, well, of course, you are influenced by a lot of music, but what music do you listen to? When you have the time, of course.
Yeah. Yeah. Lately, what has been in my CD player in my car, I judge this, when I get this question, I just have to judge it on what is in my CD player in my car. And it's there's like a singer, an Azari singer named Alim Gazimov. He's like a, he sings in the maqam. So he's somewhere between Persian and Turkish system. But Azari music is really its own thing. And there's a lot of Western, there's a lot of Russian influence in this music also. So it actually fits our discussion that we were talking about before. Azerbaijan is a really interesting cultural pivot in the world, and the music that comes from there is, to me, to my ears, it's just magic. I can't believe it when I hear it.
No, I'm so sorry. I didn't bring the CD. I feel so guilty.
No, we'll know each other. You can.
Yeah. I will make it.
Sounds good.
You are, this is a question that you've been asked for a gazillion times. As a banger head, I feel obliged to ask you again, will Mr. Banger form again and play?
It's unfortunately a question that I can't answer because I don't know the answer to it.
Okay, let me rephrase that. Do you want Mr. Banger to reform and...
Yeah, I mean, I've never thought that it shouldn't, but I have understood also that there are reasons that it shouldn't. But sometimes it seems that that's not really even the issue anymore. It's more like, if to be honest, it's more like if we think of it as if nothing has changed. Mr. Bungle, even in 2000 or, you know, 1997, we wouldn't have made an album unless we were inspired to do it, unless there was a reason to do it. So the real answer would be, if we were to do that, it would be because there was an inspiration to do it. We would never do a fucking reunion tour. That would never happen.
Okay, that was
no way. Question. That we're all agreed on for sure. Like, why the fuck would we do that? But if we had some sort of creative spark and there was some reason to collaborate again, I mean that's the only thing that would make it all happen again.
But do you feel like you are a child of Mr. Bungle, in musically speaking, spiritually, or Mr. Bungle is just like a past chapter in your life and you evolved from that point?
No, actually, I feel like there were a lot of things in Mr. Bungle that were sort of in a nucleus stage that I'm working with now. So like, I would hesitate to think of myself as a child of Mr. Bungle spiritually. I would hope it was the other fucking way around, you know, but I have no when I hear it, I'm like, yeah, these things are in their little seed form, and there's a lot of different ways that those could go. To me, there are endless possibilities to Mr. Bungle's let's say future as a band, if it were a creative entity still. There's no limit to, you know, conceptually and musically what that band can do.
So this is like a good news for all of Mr. Bungle fans.
I don't think so. No, because they can't really get their hopes up about it.
Okay. I just pretended Mr. Bungle will form again.
It's
50 years from
it's
now.
One of it's these intangible things about, you know, creative inspiration. That would be the only thing, and nobody can predict if that.
But
would
at least you don't put aside the
I don't.
The thing.
I don't think Mike does anymore either. But we have, not everybody's in the same opinion on it.
Okay.
You wanted to ask him about the whole event.
Oh, okay, yeah, right. I am beside being a Bungle fan, and Secret Chiefs fan, and Phenomenal fan, I'm also an extreme music fan, and I also like brutal death metal.
Uh-huh.
And
you're gonna like our new drummer.
Yeah. I read somewhere that Holy Van. Is that how it is pronounced?
Yeah, that's how we pronounce
it. Is going to put out an album or an EP? Is that going to happen?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. That's good news for me. Because I really love those songs from the
record. Yeah, there's a lot left to do with that idea.
Yeah. And I searched on the internet about the Holy Van members, and I also found out that the vocals from the Holy Van is a member of a Canadian band, Unhuman, which is connected to Cryptopsy and Auguri and a lot of bands that I really love. So.
Yeah, it's that Montreal progressive crazy death metal thing. But I mean, Unhuman is very much his own person. Really interesting musician.
So, I really look forward to listening to the next.
Me too. I can't wait to get some time to work on it. That'll be it. I don't know when it's going to happen, but it has to happen soon.
Soon, in the world of Secret Chiefs 3, soon it could be 5 years, 10 years. I don't know.
Yeah, we don't. The time scales don't really apply to Secret Chiefs. It's weird.
I don't know. I know your answer will be off, but what band would you recommend people from your label, Web of Mimicry?
What band should they listen to from Mimicry?
Yeah.
It depends on what music you like to listen to. If you like extreme sort of death stuff, the Cleric album.
I tried to listen to the Cleric, but it's not my cup of tea.
Is it too crazy?
Yeah.
Okay, because the other one would be Fat 32, which is even crazier. And they played here with us in Bucharest 2 years ago.
I was at work when they played. When you played, I was there.
They're
I came up late.
Yeah, and speaking of your last passing through here, we know you had some issues with your bus last time.
Ah, yeah, just after the show.
Is your new bus better?
We don't have a bus, we just have a van.
Van, yeah.
Yeah, it's fine. So well, the problem was we would drive to Istanbul.
Yeah.
Directly after the show here, and
this time
it's just Sofia, so it's not so far.
Oh.
It'd be easier.
Yeah, that was the next question. Where are we going?
Sofia, then Timișoara, then Belgrade, Serbia, and Croatia.
Yeah,
Slovenia.
I ask this question all the time to American bands. How does it feel, European public versus American public?
Well, there are definitely a few different Europes. I can tell you that. Just like there are a few different Americas too.
Yeah.
Well, there's South America and North America first
yeah.
of all.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
she East. Meant U.S. public.
Yeah, I understand. But even that, you know, the West Coast and the East Coast are very different, and the South is very different. So I would say in the cities where we traditionally play in the United States, it's very strong support. We have good, strong audiences.
That means California states.
California,
like that.
But you know, Portland and Seattle, Washington, Oregon, and. Of course, New York City, Montreal in Canada is a very good city for us.
So the liberal states.
It can be more difficult in the southern states. Yeah. It can. Yeah. The South has a few places that are really good too, though. So for us, Europe is also like this. For us, Portugal is really good, really solid support. France is really our home base in Europe because our booking agent is based there. We play there a lot. But sometimes we play somewhere in France and there's hardly anybody there. Other times there's tons of people. You can't predict. You know, it's really hard to predict. We make an effort to come to Eastern Europe because it's frankly it's depressing to only play in like the rich countries of Europe because it reminds us of our own. Just play in like, you know, the nice places, you're missing all the best places to play. You know, like that's just our instinct is, well, fuck, I'm not gonna listen to Western European promoters and say, oh, why, you know, why play Romania, why, you know, why bother? Then they're telling you that because it's their commission that they get from it. They're 15% on the gig, they don't make as much money. I'm not gonna listen to that crap. So we're lucky, we have a great booking agent who is really committed to helping us go, like next year we go to Russia, we finally go to Finland, you know, we've been playing in like Estonia and Lithuania.
Okay, the Baltic countries.
It's important, you know. We'll be playing in Morocco next year, in Turkey, Cyprus.
Cyprus in the Greek part or the Turkish part?
Probably the Turkish part. Greece is hard. But that's like been the hardest thing. Is we even tried to play in Macedonia and this, then it got cancelled.
Because of the few tickets?
Not really sure. I mean, we're pretty adventurous, we'll take chances. And yeah, it just hasn't come together. We just haven't met the right people yet.
Yeah. I don't know much about Macedonia, but from what I remember, they are like the cousins of Bulgarians.
Yeah, right.
Linguistically.
It's more like that, yeah. It's not so much Greece.
Not Greece.
Yeah, I know. But for, you know, so we just played in Brazil and it was beautiful, you know. You expect it to be like I don't know why. It's another thing where, you know, all you ever hear about is the favelas and how fucked up everything is. And then you go there, like, they paid us better than we've ever been paid on any gig ever in Brazil on our first show. You just can't tell. So that's what I'm saying, like, I think that a lot of times booking agents and bands are really reluctant to do things. They're reluctant to take a chance of maybe lose money or something. It's very stupid. They're missing everything. Everything that's good happens when you stick your head out a little bit farther.
At least in Romania, I can tell from experience, it's very hard to come and play in Romania because the audience is so small every time. And you will never get the amount of money you get from Western Europe.
And this is the problem is the expectation that a band has. You know, if they're like, well, we expect this much money for this and this. What happens the second time you come? I mean, the first time we came to Romania, we didn't lose money.
Oh.
We broke even, so there's no problem there. And then you come, yeah. The second time you come, there's more people. That's how it works everywhere. It's not unique to Romania. I just think bands are timid and afraid and not very adventurous. For us, it's not like a, you know, slitting our wrist to drive to Romania. We drive to the United States, you know? Can you imagine? You start in San Francisco, you drive for two entire fucking days. There's nothing, there's nowhere to play. Then you're finally in Utah, you play a show there. You drive an entire day, then you're in Denver. You drive another 2 days, nothing, there's nothing. Until you get to Chicago, unless you go up north, you know, to Minnesota. But what I'm saying is we're used to driving long distances for shows.
So it's not a problem here in Europe.
What's the problem? Big deal. It's a day drive. Get off your ass and fucking, you know, tour, you know?
It would be great if all the bands would think like that.
I don't understand why they don't. I don't know what the hell their problem is. I do have some insight. It's because Western European promoters are telling them not to, because it's not worth it. I'm trying to push this because I wanted to make them feel ashamed and start fucking booking bands here.
Yeah, no, in fact, we were last year in Sofia, Sick of It All.
No, yeah.
Yeah, and they told us that their promoter told them that not to come to Romania because we have bad roads and such.
Exactly.
And Bulgaria is not better than Romania in this.
The United States has much worse roads than Romania, I'm telling you. Unless you get off, you know, I mean, I've driven all over Romania. Yes, there's some really fucked up roads when you get off the bigger roads.
Yeah.
But the big roads are fine. It's no problem. This is the bullshit.
Please don't help our government with this statement. Yeah, speaking of politics, what do you think about Obama's win?
Who?
Okay. We got
it. Yeah,
it's a
fiasco.
Okay.
What can I say?
Well,
I guess it's a little bit better for us that he would win. It's a little bit easier for the rest of the world.
Yeah.
So it seems.
We have a thing.
I don't know. Man.
Against
religion,
so we feel relief that Romney didn't get elected because he's fucked up.
Well, in my opinion, the problem is not. The problem is that the religion, so-called, that ends up achieving all of this power and prominence, especially in the United States, is a pseudo-religion. It's not really a religion.
Every religious guy will tell you exactly the same thing. Those priests and the churches, they are not the real religion. But actually, this is the real religion.
I mean, the real religion takes place between, you know, a person and God.
Yes.
So, but that doesn't mean that a church or a gathering, a grouping, is just inherently bullshit because there's more than one person there.
Mm.
I actually think that there is such thing. What matters is continuity through time. If something can hold itself together and last and not change, one generation to the next, to the next, to the next, to the next, then there's something there. If it changes every generation, there's nothing there. That's so. It's fair to use the term pseudo-religion.
Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Okay.
Sorry.
So